because he's worthy to be praised. And we're here today thanking God for our pastor and his family, because today we're celebrating his third anniversary here at Macedonia Missionary Baptist Church. We have been tremendously blessed, and we are tremendously grateful for his service and for his family. So today, we're going to open up with Psalms 100. If you please stand as we invite the Holy Spirit into this place to have its way to rule and reign in our lives as we give God some glory today. Psalms 100. When you're ready, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Amen. All ye lands, let serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good. Is the Lord good?
Yes.
His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth for all generations.
Amen. Father God, we come this morning to say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For this another day's journey.
Yes.
We realize, Heavenly Father, this is a day that we've never seen before.
Yes.
And we want to see you again. This is a special day, Father. This is a day that we honor one of your great servants.
Yes.
And we say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
We call and you say, well, we call unto you, you would answer us and show us great and mighty things that we're doing with our love. So we say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For the great and mighty thing that you are doing in this place and for these people. We thank you for everyone that is here this morning. And Father, we pray that you will have your way in each and every one of our lives. Bless the Heavenly Father that they will give you praise and honor and glory because it all belongs to you. We thank you now in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Can we all please remain standing as we receive our pastor and first lady?
Welcome to Macedonia Missionary Baptist Church. We thank you for coming to our amazing pastors and the mercy.
Amen.
If there are any guests here, we would like you to stand. We welcome you to this amazing church family. Please stand up, greet our guests, and greet each other.
Bye. praise dance rehearsal is Sundays right after worship experience. Of course, today will be canceled during our celebration. Chosen Generation Youth Choir rehearsal, Thursdays at 4:30 p.m. Voices of Macedonia and Praise Team rehearsals, Thursdays at 6 o'clock p.m. Adult Dance Praise Dance Team, Saturday at 12 o'clock noon. Church Business Meeting. Macedonia will be having our church business meeting on November 14th at 7 o'clock p.m. in the sanctuary. All members are welcome to attend. Just some reminders, Gospel Festival is canceled for November 15th, so prayer service and Bible study will be taking place at the normal time at 6:30 this Wednesday. No prayer service and Bible study on November 22nd due to Thanksgiving. Not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday. This Wednesday we're having Bible study. So don't forget your obedience challenge. New members orientation is Tuesdays at 3 o'clock p.m. and second and fourth Sundays at 9:30 a.m. Prayer service and Bible study is every Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. Sunday school, Sunday at 9:30 a.m. And worship experience is Sunday at 11 o'clock a.m. All right, thank you.
praise all over the house. Come on, Psalm 107 and 2 says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Come on, you ought to open up your mouth and give God praise all over this house. Come on, you could be dead in the mortuary, but you alive in the sanctuary. You ought to give God praise. Come on, I got three reasons to give God praise. One, he woke me up this morning. Maybe that ain't all right for somebody. Let me talk to this side. Two, he woke me up this morning. I got another one. He woke me up this morning. Come on, he started me on my way. I got the activity of my limbs. I got life and breath inside of me. You ought to give God praise. Come on, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Come on, I didn't say against me, with me. Let us exalt his name together. Why? Together we'll be blessed. Come on, together we'll be healed. Come on, together we'll be lifted up. Together we'll be restored. Today we'll have our joy back. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. When the praises go up, the blessings come down. I don't need an organ to praise him. I can, if I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't praise him enough. Somebody waiting for a beat in the dance and a melodic tune, but you ought to just think of the goodness of Jesus. Come on, when I think, I should begin to thank. And all he's done for me, my soul cries out. There's two times to praise God. One when you feel like it, but two when you don't. There's two types of praises to give God. One is a reflex praise. That just means I'm a spiritual hype man when I'm a spiritual Simon Says. When I tell you to clap your hands, you do that. I tell you to stomp your feet and shout hallelujah, you do that too. I got to poke and prod you to do it. That's a reflex praise. But there's a deeper level of praise, and this is a reflect praise. Reflect means I got to go back down memory lane. Reflect means about me thinking about where I could have been, what I should have been, where I should be, who I used to be. Y'all don't want to talk to me today. Reflect means when I think, I can't shut my mouth, but when I think, I gotta begin to thank. And open up my mouth and give God praise. Come on, just take 3 seconds and give God praise all over this house. Come on, you ought to praise him. You ought to open up your mouth and give grace to the King of Kings. Lord of Lords, take somebody's hand, if you will, and leave no one untouched. Surely, this morning as I was musing and meditating about what to pray before the message,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My mind took me to the woman with the issue of blood. Yes. Found in the synoptic gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we find a woman vexed and afflicted for 12 years.
Yes, sir.
I believe if she was alive today, she would have had a starring role in the movie 12 Years a Slave.
Yes.
For 12 years, she was a slave to her situation.
We
don't know her name. All we know is the nature of her situation. Imagine going through life being known as the man who went to prison. Being known as the woman who was divorced. Being known as the person who was X this or that. We all X something in here. And I'd like to believe that woman with the issue of blood was given a name. There was something on her birth certificate that spoke not about her issue, but about who she was. But even though we don't know her name, God knows her name, and he knows our name. He knows the nature of our situation, and he sees that we're in the right place at the right time, in the right season, for a right word from God. And some of us in here have been carrying some issues for 10, 12, 15, 20 years. But if you can be like her and just press your way to Jesus, one word from the Lord can say, woman, thou art loose. One word from the Lord can say, loose the man and let him go. The woman with the issue of blood didn't touch H-I-M. She didn't touch Jesus, but she touched the H-E-M of his garment. And was made whole from that very hour. As you're touching somebody's hand today, you're touching somebody who's touching the Lord. You're touching somebody who can get a prayer through for you. This is what a miracle feels like today. This is what it feels like to hold somebody's hand who's been through dangers, toils, and snares, but they're still here. They may not have $1 million, but they have a relationship with the Lord that money can't buy. Why don't you just pray, not just for yourself, but pray for that hand you hold. Kind and gracious Father, we come to just say thank you, God. We thank you, God, for this occasion today. We thank you that we're celebrating, not just commemorating, but we're celebrating a great visionary that you have placed in this particular vineyard for such a time as this. Father, let your anointing flow in us, to us, through us, for us, by us, and with us. Because Jesus, you are our peace, you are our praise, you are our presence and our power. So, Father, move until you get through. Speak until we know it's you. We don't just praise you because it's convenient. We praise you because you've been consistent in our lives. Morning by morning, new mercies we're able to see. So, Father, let my tongue be as the pen of a ready writer to write upon the tablets of the hearts of your people. And we're claiming joy in the life of my brother today. We're claiming a turnaround in my sister's life. Dry every tear-stained eye in the name of Jesus. Turn every limp into a leap. Give us healing and power right now in the name of Jesus. Devil, we serve you notice. Loose your hold right now. Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. We come against every hurt, harm, and danger. We come against it right now. Every attraction and distraction of the enemy. We bind it up in the name of Jesus. Father, do something unusual in this house. Let it be like you sit on us as cloven tongues as the fire, even in the upper room, Father, as we're gathered on one accord today. And Father, don't just visit us, but inhabit the praises of your people. And so we praise you for what you will do in my brother's life, what you will do in my sister's life. Squeeze that hand ever so gently. I squeeze healing in your hand. I press a financial breakthrough in your hand right now. Ooh, I squeeze joy. I squeeze peace. I squeeze life in that more abundantly. I squeeze your next level right now. I squeeze victory and victorious living in the name of Jesus. And Father, we don't only want to thank you for what you've done. We want to thank you for what you didn't do. We want to thank you for the house we did not lose. We want to thank you for the son that did not go to jail. We want to thank you for the daughter who was not killed and assassinated. We want to thank you right now for the disease we did not catch. We want to thank you for the bullet that did not have our name on it. We want to thank you for all you've done for us. Now let your people be edified, the devil horrified, and your name glorified in Jesus' name. Now loose those hands and give them a praise all over this house. For what he's done, but praise him for what he didn't do. He's worthy of all our praise. I don't know what you come to do, but I come to praise the Lord. I come to clap my hands. I come to stomp my feet. I don't know what you come to do. Come on, give somebody a holy hug, a high five. Shrink the place a little bit more. Tell him it's good to see you today. Yes, tell him it's good to see you. Your name may be Jane, but you won't leave the same way you came. My name is Eddie, but right about now I'm ready for a move of God. Amen, amen. Yeah, sound man, give me all the mind as you can. I'm working on broken pieces a little bit. I need you to mend me. Truly we do honor the Lord today for his love and saving power. We honor the great preaching patriarch of this house, the indubitable, the indomitable, the powerful, prolific, and prophetic preacher in the person and personality of the Right Reverend Bobby Joe McKenzie. Come on, somebody. Come on, you ought to take 3 seconds and thank God for 3 years. And while you're praising God for him, don't forget about her. They in purple for a reason. It's royalty. Come on, give God praise. Come on, for Lady Justine McKenzie. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. Praise God for him and her too. Come on, you can do better than that. If you can get excited about somebody who comes every now and then, you ought to appreciate who's here all the time.
Oh, yes.
We thank God for them, and on this 3-year pastoral anniversary, you will go down in your program and see the litany of accomplishments that speak to who he is and what God has placed inside of him as a visionary. And I don't take it lightly to be here again with you all in Albion. Yes, I'm coming off the plane and making a 2-hour drive to you, but I wouldn't change it for the world. Yes, indeed. And so we have a leader in our minds and in our midst who's tapped into the unlimited power of God. You know, the Bible says in Jeremiah 3:15 that God would give you pastors after his own heart. And we know that he has a call to us in the community. He loves God, he loves ministry, but he loves people. You know, in this business, you got some folks up in the pulpit who don't even like people. And I love as well what the Reverend Jeremiah Wright suggested. He said, there's nothing wrong with being a copycat as long as you know the right cat to copy. And in fact, Reverend McKenzie is that cat. Somebody give God praise again for him. Yes. See what God does is how he wraps. It takes God some time to put a man together and present him to you. And it may take him 30 years, it may take him 40 years, 50 years, whatever he does, but we analyze him in 30, 40, 50 minutes, much less seconds. And God takes time to do that. Amen. And so we thank God for him. Amen. You know, this level of ministry isn't easy. Pastor McKenzie, it's interesting dealing with our people, and it ain't no easy task. I'm gonna step on your toes today, and I promise I'll pray for every nub, piggly, wiggly. Blessed are the feet of them that bring the gospel of peace. One thing you won't be able to say is that I didn't tell you the truth, and so you gotta understand who you have in your midst. You know, the pastor's the first one on the side of marital matrimony. He's the last one on the side of burial mortuary. And then he's in the middle of yours and my acrimony. He covers all bases. He's on the first side of matrimony, holy matrimony, the last side of burial mortuary. Then he's in the middle of your issue. He's in the middle of your acrimony, so I think he deserves a little bit of praise and a little of your money. He may not see it, but I will for him. A workman is worthy of his hire. Amen. And so we thank God for him and them, and to all of my fellow yoke servants in the vineyard, to these mellifluous, melodious, and euphonious young people who sang today. Come on, give God praise for them. Praise God for these praise dancers. Yes, come on. If we don't accept the kids and our children, the streets will do something with them. Amen. It's interesting that Pastor has our young people serving on his anniversary. The same fifth Sunday, y'all. And so that tells you right there, he's a forward-thinking preacher and pastor, because he recognizes that the future of this church ain't about you and me, but it's about them. You got to train up a child in the way that they should go. Yeah, Tavis Smiley said, young people are like Kodak film, all they need is development and exposure. Frederick Douglass said, if we build strong children, we won't have to repair broken adults. To save them, and we also have to build them. Amen. Listen, I need you to do two things for me today. First, pray for me and with me. And secondly, just nudge somebody sitting next to you and just tell them how much they owe you for allowing them to sit next to you. Come on, tell them. Pay up right now. Come on, tell them you owe me $50 in addition to your tithe and offering. Come on. You better recognize who you sitting next to. You may not want to embrace me, but you can't repeal and replace me. That's for about 45 of y'all. I'm going to leave that number alone. I don't even count. When I count in my 40s now, it was 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 46. Don't mess with me today. Amen. Laughter's medicine. I got to give you a dose. Because in this day and time, we need more than just information. We need revelation for every situation. In the perilous times that we live in, as we see recently, 26 people killed at a church in Sutherland Springs, Texas, just last Sunday. We need a message to deal with the mess in this age. I don't know about y'all, but don't try my pastor. I'll fight for my pastor. All right, y'all don't want to talk to me now. And look at your neighbor and say, I'll fight for you too. Some of y'all didn't say nothing. I'm a pastor. You got to help me up in here. I'll fight for my pastor. Don't mess with my pastor now. Don't mess with my pastor. Look at somebody say, don't mess with my pastor now. Keep your name off my pastor's name. Yes, yes. Amen. I call your attention to the book of Luke chapter 5, verse 1. He said, touch not my anointed. Amen. Luke chapter 5, verse 1. I want you to go there with me. I brought some material with me that will bless you. I'm generally on pace to write a book a year recently. I don't know how I'm finding time, but I'm making time to do it. Luke chapter 5, verse 1. I want you to turn there. I've got some books with me that'll bless you. You know, there's 66 books in the Bible. I've only written 7 of my own, so I've got a long way to go. I'm a living witness. Your test is a testimony. Your misery is ministry. Your mess is a message. Your stumbling block is a stepping stone. And what God will do is He will use your setback as a setup for your greatest comeback. Y'all don't mind if I come down. He'll literally use your tragedy as strategy to move your life to the next level. Why? Because you're looking at a miracle today. I don't know about you, but my testimony is I don't look like what I've been through. Yeah. From many dangerous toils and stairs. So I'm from the east side of Detroit. For those who don't know, now you know. I got some Detroiters in here or some transplants. There we go. All right, don't be stirred. I see you. Yes. And so age of 15, diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. NHL. I thought it was past the National Hockey League. I said, I'm getting ready to be the youngest owner of a National Hockey League team. I don't even like the sport. I see too many white players hitting a black puck. I don't know about that. I lay that low. Black things been getting hit for 400 years. I'll leave that low. But I'm a living witness that God brings you through to give a testimony to help somebody else come out of the same situation. Chemotherapy, radiation. Y'all see these waves today? Lost all my hair. My own father never visited me one day in the hospital. But when father forsake you, the Lord will take you up. I don't know about you, but my mama prayed for me. So I've got a book here, My Brother's Keeper. Where all my brothers at? Say, yeah. Yeah, there it is. All my tenors and basses in here. My Brother's Keeper. The first question in scripture ever recorded is God asking man a question. He says, Adam, where are you after you've sinned against me and eaten of the tree that is not good for consumption? I told you not to do it. The question now is not a question of location. It's a question of proximity and relationship with God. Because where can you go that God does not know? Amen. If I make my bed in hell, He's there. But the second question, or maybe not even the second question, a few scriptures later, as we see Cain slays his brother Abel, now we see not God asking man a question, but man asking God a question. And He says, am I my brother's keeper? And it's a question that we continue to ask when we look at the police brutality, when we look at black-on-black crime, when we look at us as we assassinate each other sometimes with not a gun, but our tongue. You know, some folks will speak to you in tongues but cuss you out in English. Blessing and cursing proceed from the same mouth at the same time. I'm going to leave that alone. But this is a book that will bless you. Dr. King says, if we fail to live together as brothers, we'll perish together as fools. We're going to either hang together or hang separately, but we're going to hang. My last last one here is my seventh one, my latest one. Where are my queens at? Oh, my ladies? Yeah. Come on, do three snaps and a neck roll, a hair flip. Give your sister a high five, tell her, you go, girl. It's your bad self. You all that in a bag of Bibles, girl. It's your bad self. You all that a certain scriptures with yourself, girl. This is a book here that I know will bless you. It's been endorsed by Dr. Michael Eric Dyson and Bishop T.D. Jakes. Queen means quintessentially unique, empowering everyone naturally. I'll say this, real queens don't compete, they collaborate. Real queens don't chase a man, they chase their purpose and plan, and the right man's gonna chase and pursue them. Real queens understand that their royalty demands loyalty. They wear their crown and they build their queendom in the kingdom of God. So this is a book that will bless you. Both of these, they're all on clearance today. They all will bless you. Luke chapter 5, verse 1. If you have it, say, mm-hmm. I don't want you to text message. I want you to look at the message in the text. I don't want you to get on Facebook. I want you to put your face in this book. If you have a Bible, share it with someone next to you. If they don't have a Bible, get new friends. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. Saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were going out of them. They were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and talked the people out of the ship. Jesus is a carpenter, he's a teacher. We know that by trade. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. Now this is interesting. Jesus by trade is not a fisherman. Yes, he's a rabbi, as they would call him. He's a teacher. But by trade, he's a carpenter. Have you ever had somebody come into your space trying to tell you to do what you already have experience in? I've been an engineer for 30 years. I've been a teacher for this amount of years. How you gonna tell me how to do my job? Y'all don't like me to talk about Jesus like that. Verse 5, and Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night. We've worked laboriously and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Now, why did Simon give Jesus the excuse before he acquiesced and said yes? The scripture really should read, and Simon answering said unto him, Master, at thy word, I will let down the net. Now, why do you give God all these excuses about what you will or won't do when he knows what you have need of before you even complain about it? Not ask, but complain. As verse 6 says, and when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes and their net break. I want you to help me with this text and this title today. Just look at somebody and tell them, you've been in the boat too long. Tell them you've been in the shallow end way too long. Tell them launch out. Now, that's the wrong neighbor. Look at the other neighbor. Tell them you've been where you've been. Way too long. Launch out. Launch out. Open with the fact that God is never recognized, but rather he is always revealed. God is everywhere. He is omnipresent. But the question becomes, how is God anywhere if you or I don't meet him somewhere? Somebody in your pew may get a revelation of God, but if you're twiddling your thumbs or if you're on Twitter, the revelation will bypass you and hit them to where they get an experience of God because they're on tiptoe anticipation. They're on the edge of their seat waiting for God to move in their life so that the word will cause them to launch farther and deeper. But if you don't have any expectation, then it'll bypass you and it'll hit them and you'll say, well, what is this all about? Because your mind has not conceptualized what God wants to do in your life. I don't know about you, but you woke up this morning expecting something. Yes, sir. You came in this house expecting something. Yes, sir. And you ought to place a demand on God to say, God, I'm not leaving this house until you move in my spouse, until you move in my life. Because when I receive a blessing in this house, I know you're already working it out in my house. But the question becomes, as I said, how is he anywhere if you or I don't meet him somewhere? And so what God does is he meets us in the ordinariness, the ordinary circumstances of our lives to bring something extraordinary out of an ordinary experience. He brings a message out of our mess. He brings a testimony out of our test. He turns our stumbling blocks into stepping stones, and our tragedy is used as a strategy to overcome every attack of the enemy.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You have to realize and recognize this afternoon that knowing God is not contained in what you have. It's not contained in your money or your honey, your Benz or your friends, your debit or credit that probably still can't get it. But knowing him is in a relationship with God. Why? Because Paul said, oh, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. But guess what? I have to also know him in the fellowship of his suffering. See, we want to preach resurrection, but not suffering. We want to preach receiving a crown, but you have to go through a cross experience to be able to wear the crown that God wants to place on you. I have to be able to bear the burdens of my brother and my sister. I have to be able to not just go through, but grow through, because the trying of your faith worketh experience, experience patience, patience experience, and experience hope. Why? Simply because you can never know who you are until you know whose you are. You can never come into the awareness of what God has placed inside of you until you begin to connect with him. To say, Lord, what is it that you have placed on the inside of me to be able to operate my life? I don't know what car you drive, but if you pulled up with your ceiling missing, pulled up to the scene with your ceiling missing, you pulled up in a Lamborghini two-door Murcielago, whatever it is, you would understand that I can't put 20 people in a two-seat car because everybody can't go with me to where I'm supposed to go. Are you cramming people in your life who don't even belong on your journey to your destiny? In your season, you might be at a stop sign, and the stop sign means I got to open up the door and let you out to let you know that it's not personal, but it's just business, and I must be about my Father's business. But in order to work the Lamborghini Murcielago, what I need to do is read the manual. Because if I just push the start and I just say I just want to drive, I'm only going to use probably 2% of the power that I could actually ascertain to use with the vehicle. I got my music going. I got my air coming out. I got my heat going and blowing, and now your hair is all over the place. Yes, but if you don't read the manual, you can never know how to operate the car fully. And God is saying, if you don't get into the manual of my word, you will not know how to operate your life to the capacity that I have created you to use it. And rather than launching out, you will stay in a shallow place with shallow people, with your shallow-minded self. But when you begin to tap into my word and open up the scripture and say, Lord, speak to me, show me what you placed in me so that I can begin to stir up my gift and tell the enemy, my past is a prison, yes, but my future is freedom, and I will have power power in the name of Jesus. Some of y'all still holding out on me. That's all right. I'm going to preach this thing anyway. And when you come into the reality of who you're created to be, then you can say, I am a child of the living God because I am who I am by the grace of God. Can I take it further? I'm wondering, can you still trust God when you can't trace him? When your back is against the wall, when no one will pick up the phone, will you still seek his throne? I'm learning that you got to learn how to take a knee. And that's not just on a football field, but that's also with your faith. You got to send God an email and say, Lord, I need a word from you. I need you to bring my son out. I need you to deliver my daughter. I need you to cause me to dance into my destiny, because the enemy is attacking me and I have to have the victory by any means necessary. And so this is why the scripture is relatable and relevant to your life, because when life knocks you down, you're really in the perfect position to pray. And oftentimes you and I have been in a shallow place. We've been hesitant to take the next step, fearful of progress, and God wants us to launch out into the deep. And oftentimes after instruction now comes demonstration. And when Jesus commenced his teaching from the boat, he commanded Simon to launch out into the deep and to let down his net. Just like Simon, you and I have all these excuses why we won't do what God is telling us to do. And you say, God, I've been there, I've done that. I've got a t-shirt and a website. Nothing new has transpired. What will they say if I go this way? What will they say if this happens? What will they say if I do? The only person you need to be concerned about judging you is God himself. Because folks will judge you and don't even have a law degree. But when God tells you to move, you got to move just like that. Why? Because he wants to get some glory out of your story. But the only way to get it out is for you to launch out. I looked at your theme. Why? Because for you to live victoriously, you have to launch out as a visionary. You got to see beyond what you see. Look at somebody and tell them, this is your season for season. This is your season for seizing some things. Seizing your healing. Seizing your joy. Because if you don't see it before you see it, you never will seize it. And that's why the Bible says the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. You got to seize your thing. You got to seize your joy, your peace, your power, your prosperity. You got to shake yourself and say, devil, you pick it up, but I'm walking in my healing. I'm walking in my joy, my determination, my destination for revelation. Look at somebody and tell them, it's your time. It's your time. And why? Because today God is not only lifting you, but God is launching you. Why? Because there's a difference between lifting and launching. Lifting requires gravity, and that is what goes up must come down. But launching speaks to another level, because what goes out might not necessarily come back in. The farther I get out is the farther God's going to show me greater things to come. To launch means to take off the drag and the excess weight on you in order to propel you to the next level. You got to recognize and realize today that God is removing the weight on you in order to launch you into another realm and on another level. And that's why he said in Hebrews to lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset you. How can I run my race if I'm burdened down by depression? How can I run my race if I'm burdened down by what Susie so-and-so says and what Pookie and Ray-Ray gonna say? Where would I got to listen to God and tune you out so that I can hear what thus saith the Lord, so that when he tells me to go right, I won't go left. When he tells me to go ahead, I won't look back and go back. But I've got to move in the place to where God is getting ready to put you and I into orbit like a space shuttle. But in order for the shuttle to launch farther and higher, it has to let go of the rocket boosters. And God is saying, in order for me to launch you to another level, in order for you to stretch out your faith, you're going to have to let go of some stinking thinking. You're going to have to let go of some bad habits. You're going to have to let go of some addictions. You're going to have to let go of being controlled by your flesh. You're going to have to let go to grow, to say, I'm walking in holiness, because holiness is still right, y'all. I messed up today. Following after God is still right. Yeah, I got to listen to him so that I know where he's leading me, because where he leads, I will follow. To say, I'm done with this stuff. The more, how many yeses will you tell the devil, and how many more no's will you tell God? Because nothing is happening because you're not doing anything to accelerate the kingdom. But when I begin to tell the devil no and tell God yes, then I can move in the blessings that he has for me. Just look somebody, tell them, God ain't gonna bless your mess. You got to follow after righteousness. It ain't even about me, my good works, because your righteousness is as filthy rags. I know you've been in the church a long time, but maybe you've been in the way a long time. You've been sitting on your pew, but you're still feeling old. Talking about what's on the outside, because the outward man perisheth, but the inward man is being renewed day by day. And I need to not only fill the pews. Can I preach this thing, Pastor? The sad thing about the church is where we have lost it, is that we focus more so on membership than discipleship. We messing up because we focused on the sister who walked in who's low and high. We focused on the brother who's smelling like ganja, high as a Georgia pie. He got his pants sagging, but guess what? He's coming from a sagging home. He's coming from a sagging community. He's got sagging relationships. He's coming from a sagging school system. The governmental structure is sagging. The church, God forbid, is sagging. But if you pull up the home, if you pull up the church, if you pull up the community, if you pull up the relationship, if you pull up the school, if you pull up his life, he will pull up his path. Feel it in here. Look at somebody and tell them, don't pull me down. Pull me up. Oh, God. So it is here then that I have to walk according to the dictates and the mandates of God. Why? Because God is always right. I don't care how right it felt, it was wrong. But God is always right. God was speaking to you through your mama. He told you that man wasn't good. Your sister told him he wasn't good. Your older brother told him he wouldn't. He told you himself, you don't want to mess with me. God told you, you wouldn't listen to him. But you had to have what you had to have. Oh, God. You thought he was a Boaz, but he found out he was a bozo. Thought you found you a Ruth, but she couldn't tell you the truth. 36:24-36, curves like the letter S. But the sister was a snake. Thought you found you a Morris, Walnut, Chestnut, whoever he was. But you found out the brother was a nut. And those were the folks in the church. Oh, yes. But I got to have some discernment. Just because you sit on my pew don't mean you my people. You may be fine, but you ain't mine. Because I can see a devil in a blue dress, red dress, green dress, whatever dress. Because God will give me discernment to see what I should take and what I should pass on. Look at somebody, tell them there's a blessing in passing. Because what God wants to do is take you to the next level. He's got to get you to a place to where you launch out to where he said, I'm going to make your haters bless you. You got to know that there's still enough time in 2017. We're in November, right? God said, I'm going to still make it a November to remember. Because there's still enough time left in this year for it to be the best year of your life. God will do in the next few weeks what months couldn't do in the past. Because he said, I'll make your enemies your footstool. I'll prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And all you have to do is sit down and eat, because he's given you a reserved seat. God will bless you so good that he'll make your enemies prepare your plate. Look at somebody, tell them, table for two people, please. I saved you a seat. It's up to you if you're going to launch out with me or not. But you got to stay in position to receive the revelation for your acceleration. Look at somebody and tell them, it's still your year for acceleration. Because I'm not just opening my hand to praise and worship God, but I'm opening my hand to receive what he has for me. And the sad indictment is that oftentimes we seek God's hand, but we don't want to hear from his heart. But he said, as the deer panted after the water, so my soul, my heart, my mind, my spirit, my emotions, they long after thee. Do I have just enough? Do I got about 20 folk in this house that say, yes, it's still my time, because I'm launching to the next level. God, this for all the young folk 30 and under, it's levels to this. Because God said, I'm getting ready to save your marriage. I'm getting ready to save your son. I'm getting ready to save your daughter, your grandchildren, your house, and your spouse. You will not foreclose on your mortgage. Not this year, not anytime, not at all. You're not gonna wallow and waylay in debt. Because he said, I'm gonna supply all your need according to his riches and glory. The building fund for the next building is already yours. The governmental favor is already yours. The place, he said, I've given you the land, and wherever your feet shall trod is already yours. He said, Pastor, I've given you the vision because I've already released the provision. And he said, it's already yours before you took a knee to praise me. It's already yours before you lifted your hands to worship me. Nobody can block it and nobody can stop it. You got to stop knocking on doors that won't open. Because there's a blessing in blocking sometimes. And God blocked it because he knows that if one door closes, two are getting ready to open. Look at somebody and tell him, he gonna give me some double for my trouble. Yes, but I got to speak to the atmosphere. I got to put cancer under my feet. I got to lay hands on myself and say, in the name of Jesus, I am healed, set free, and delivered. You got to open up your mouth and speak to the atmosphere. Because once you speak to the atmosphere, your victory shall appear. Your words create your world, because death and life is in the power of your tongue. But you're saying, I ain't got nothing. Why? You ain't got nothing? It's because you ain't said nothing. You got to open up your mouth and say, in the name of Jesus. Do you got a praise in your spirit that'll move God off his balcony? That'll move God off his throne and say, who was that who called my name? They may not be right, but they still know how to live my name. They've made some mistakes, but I'm looking over my heavenly balcony. I got to to bless Brother Ray. I got to bless Sister Sally Sue. I got to bless you because you called my name out of the hunger of your heart. Because they that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. You know why you ain't been filled? Because you've been chasing folk who leave you depleted. Yeah, you chasing a man, but where's your plan? I feel like preaching in here. You chasing after him, but what about him? God, I feel it in here. I feel like preaching in here. Something up in here, I don't know what it is. But it is the Spirit of the living God. God said, you got to chase after me. And when you chase after me, you don't have to chase after things. You never have to chase after what you've chosen to receive. But all I have to do is stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And praise him in the hallway till he opens the door. And when I get in the door, I'll praise him like I was just in the hallway, harder than where he brought me out of. But I'm not chasing them, I'm chasing him. And I have to place myself in a position to receive what God has for me. Because I heard him say to the Syrophoenician woman, oh woman, great is your faith. He called the woman a dog. But she said, yes, blessed is he or she who is not offended in me. But I'm still going to receive what I need from the Lord. I'm wondering, do I got some people in here with some great faith? Because I heard him say to Lazarus, loose the man and let him go. But some of y'all praise is too puny. Your worship is too weak. You focused on Trump, but you won't allow God to move you in a place to triumph. Yes. Because he said the cart of the king is in the hand of the Lord, and he turneth it whithersoever he will. And so I ain't got to hate. All I got to do is celebrate the name of the living God, because the government shall be on his shoulders. God. Look at somebody and tell them, you focusing on government, you need to focus on God. Yes, because he's the one that's going to supply me with his riches in glory. But I got to be so desperate for him that I can't be denied. For they that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. And I'm the reason you've been dehydrated and you've been parched is because you're waiting for people to quench your thirst, when only God can satisfy. Can he satisfy your soul? Can he satisfy your spirit if you ain't got $1 million in the bank? Can he satisfy you if you never walk down the aisle with a spouse? Can he satisfy you if you never live in a 50 bedroom mansion? Can he satisfy you to say, Jesus, I love you so much that I'm grateful just another day? You ought to take 10 seconds and give God praise to say, launching out. I'm like Jacob, I'm wrestling, but I won't let go until you bless me. I'm not gonna let go till my son is healed. Just pull on that neighbor. Say, I'm not gonna let you go till your dream is restored. I'm not gonna let you go till your son is healed and delivered and set free. But you got to launch out and prophesy over your house. You got to speak it in the name of Jesus. You got to prophesy over your business. You got to prophesy over your community and this city and say, this is my time to not only see the vision, but to seize the vision. Because if you seize the vision, God will give you the provision. Attack that neighbor, tell them, see it and seize it. Because he said, I'm restoring to you the years that the cankerworm made up. God said, what took 7 years, I'm going to do it in 7 months. What took 7 months, I'm going to do it in 7 weeks. What took 7 weeks, I'm going to do it in 7 days. What took 7 days, I'll do it in 7 hours. What took 7 hours, I'll do it in 7 minutes. And if you said, if you praise me, I'll take what should have happened in 7 hours and do it in 7 seconds. He said, it's already done. Because for they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. And your tears are watering the seed for your harvest. I know you cried, but you didn't die. Cancer tried to knock me out. Cancer made me cry, but it didn't make me quit. Because there's a fighter on the inside of me. I'm wondering, is there a fighter on the inside of you? You've been knocked down, but you're not knocked out. You got to get back up again and say, yes, I still believe. Yes, I'm still expecting. Yes, I still believe this is my day. And if today is not the day, I know I'm one day closer to the day to where God is going to reveal it in my spirit. Oh, yeah, they neglected you, but God protected you. They rejected you, but God redirected you. They told you no in the earthly realm, but no in the spirit realm means new opportunity. For they that sow, weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. I don't know who I'm talking to, but God knows who this word is going to. And God says, today is your launch party. Today is your day to come up out of the cave. Today is your day to come out of where you've been. You've been in this place long enough, and the mountain has been, yes, but the struggle is over for you. But God said, you got to know my voice. You know Steve Harvey's voice. You know Dr. Phil's voice. But you still don't feel any better. Yonder Vans, that still ain't fixed your life. You're listening to Jeezy Weezy, Yeezy Jay-Z, Beyonce, Lil Uzi. Now you're picking up a Uzi. God help me in here. But God said, my sheep know my voice, and a stranger they will not follow. You got to know the voice of Jesus. You got to know it, because faith now begins to work by love. And since I'm in his image, why are you telling me what I can't do? That's all right if you do, but it's wrong if I believe what you say about me, because God already told me who I am and what I have on the inside of me. And since I'm made in the image of God, then why am I allowing the enemy to diminish me? Who said your lips was too big? No, baby, I can open up my big mouth and thank God for another day. Who said your nose was too wide? No, he breathed in me the breath of life, and he rolled up his sleeves and created me from the dust of the ground. Yes, who said your hair was too nappy or too kinky? No, baby, the only naps in the kinks are the ones in your mind. I got good hair. I got African in my family. Who said you were too dark or too light? No, baby, God made you just right. Black don't crack. Brown won't let you down. But also light will do you right. Look at somebody and tell them, I'll do you right. Look at somebody and tell them, put some respect on my name. Because I'm made in the image of God. And if you hurt me, I'll forgive you. I won't hold bitterness to you. I know you got an iPhone and an iPod and an iPad. But do you have I pray? Do you have I forgive? Do you have I love? Do you have I serve? Do you have I go to Bible study? Do you have I tithe? Do you have power in your spirit? Oh, God, look at somebody and tell them, you need a new eye. Yeah, you need a new eye. Because eyes have not seen, and ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men what God has prepared for them that love it. I got to get up out of here. I'm out of time, but I'm not out of truth. I'll preach this thing another time if you have me back. You ain't got to say amen, but I'll preach this thing to myself. I had to preach to myself when my hair was falling out of my head. I had to preach to myself when I had veins going in my arm with chemo and radiation. I had to preach to myself when people who I thought were praying for me were praying on me. I had to preach to myself in here. I'll blow a fuse in this place. See, when the dentist drills you, you yell ouch. But when the preacher hits you, you get quiet. But I'm going to preach this thing anyway. Because God said, I'm sending the word to turn your heart of stone into a heart of flesh. What's worse is being colder than the weather. So bad if you got folk in the church who won't even say hi to you. Won't even speak to you in tongues, but can't even hug you. Well, this is my seat. This is my auxiliary. This is my ministry. No, this is God's house. And whosoever will. Somebody. Tell them you got to come today. You got to turn your plate down and your TV off. We got to redistribute our own personal wealth now. Because too many of us are watching power, but we ain't got no Holy Ghost power. You're watching empire, but what empire will you build? God. You got to do more than buy cars and clothes and houses. Get your nail done, hair done, everything then. No, you fancy, huh? Red bottom heels, but your bank account is in the red. Fancy, but what about your finances? Will you say I am my brother's keeper? Will you say I am my sister's protector? Silver and gold have I none. Such as I have, give I thee. And if salvation isn't enough, then nothing else will be enough. But I got to have a relationship with him to say I'm not just a purchaser, but I am a creator and a producer that will launch out into the deep. Gray hair don't mean it's over, baby. That just means your wisdom is coming out. And it ain't too late to be great. Neither is it too early to get started. Ah, yes. Just let them not despise your face. Because the coming years and the viability of this church is about more than having your name on a fellowship hall wall. This ain't about your name being engraved on a pew. Brother Pookie, Sister Ray Ray, whatever it is. This is about kingdom business. To not just be a monument, but to be a movement. To say, I am the church and God is in me. And I won't only just tell you about him, but I'll show you about him. I'll show you with my love. I'll show you with my purpose. I'll show you with my peace. Because if I'm looking down on you, it only means because I'm getting ready to extend a hand to help you up and to let you know that a God who brought me this far can bring you even farther. Look at that neighbor, tell them SOS. Tell them scoot over some. If you knew what God brought me through, you might not want to sit next to me. If you knew what I used to do, if you knew who I used to be, if you knew where I used to go, if you knew what I used to say. But I'm so glad that the Lord lifted me. He saved me. He filled me. He brought me out of the miry clay. Placed my feet on the rock to stay. He put a song in my heart today. And I just want to love on them. Because we got people shouting in church on Sunday. But people are catching hell Monday through Saturday. We praying, singing songs. But we got to do more because we got people who know hip-hop, but they don't know hymns. They don't have church attire, but they do have a desire to be better. They know how to fight, but they don't know spiritual warfare. But will you love them? Will you tell them that God still has a purpose for your life? Because God will flip the script, and those who were meant to despise you, he will use them to bless you. Because I know that Jesus is a water walking, boat rocking, launching out into the deep, God. And he's coming to get some glory out of your story. Look at that neighbor, tell him it's your time to launch out. It's your your time. It's your time to move from where you've been to where God has called you to be. Because Revelation 12:11 said that we overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Do I have a few people in this house that say I have a testimony? Just nudge somebody, tell them I got a testimony. Because if you tell my story, it's journalism. But when I tell my own story, it's a testimony of what God has done for me. I'm getting ready to get up out of here. I'm getting ready to take my seat. But before I log off and sign off, just give that neighbor a high five and tell them you got some launching to do. You got some visioning to do. You got some living to do. You got some victories to get. You got some mountains to climb. And if you don't know, now that if you've never been fishing, then you know that the fish don't crowd around in the shallow end, but they're all the way out in the deep end, because I am a fisher of men, and your job is to catch the fish, but it's God's job to clean the fish. Why are you trying to clean what you should only be catching? Just catch them and allow God to make them up. Just catch them and allow God to do what he needs to do. But you got to move out of the shallow end. You can't get no revelation that's really deep because you got shallow friends. You got shallow relationships. You got a shallow mindset. You're shallow and you're selfish. But when you begin to launch out into the deep, then you'll hear a fresh revelation to say, God is calling me to a higher place of praise. Look at that neighbor saying, he's calling me to work my vision. He's calling me to move my life to the next level. Look at somebody and tell them, I've got a net. I got a net. And what I'm going to do, be like a fisherman. And I'm going to cast my net. When you throw out your net, you ought to reel it in. You ought to pull it back in and see what did you catch. I got a net and I got healing in my net. I got joy in my net. Nudge that neighbor, say, what did you catch? I caught power that's in my net. I caught life everlasting. It's in my net, because my net is moving to a place that God has commissioned me to work the vision, to write the vision, and to make it plain. God said, I'm breathing life back into your life, because you're not a worrier, but you're a prayer warrior. You're not a chump, but you're a champion. You're not a chicken, but you're an eagle. Get out of the chicken coop. Spread your wings and soar to the next level. You're not a whiner, but you're a winner. It's your time to move your life to the next level. You ought to shake somebody today and tell them it's your time to come out of sickness. It's your time to come out of transgression. It's your time to launch out into the deep and move, move. You ought to walk around this place. You ought to high five 3 people for the last 3 years and tell them God's getting ready to do something new right now. He's getting ready to do something new. He's getting ready to do something new right now, because the Bible said that he got 2 boats filled. You ought to put up 2 fingers today, because my 2 fingers means that God is giving me peace. He's giving me double for my trouble, but he's also giving me victory to live victoriously. I got victory in my mind. I got
victory in my spirit. And the Bible said that the net broke. God's getting ready to bless you so good that he's going to break every generational curse. He's going to break sickness. He's going to break poverty. He's going to break heart attack and heartache. He's going to break it. And he's going to give you double. He's going to give you two new jobs. He's going to give you two houses. He's going to give you two cars. He's going to give you double for your trouble. Because I heard when they said that they put my Savior in the grave one Friday night. He stayed in the grave Saturday. He stayed in that grave all Saturday night. But stop sitting on your dream. Stop sitting on your vision. But rise. Pick up your bed and walk. Because I looked at my hands. They look new. Looked at my feet. They did too. Look at somebody and tell them, won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he pick you up? Won't he turn you around? Won't he place your feet on the solid ground? I wonder how there's still some folks in here that get excited about the name of Jesus. Yeah, somebody just holler, Jesus. Holler, Jesus. I'm talking about Mary's baby. Holler, Jesus. The Lion of Judah. And the, taking a leap biblically, he's Abraham's man of faith. He's Isaac's ram in the bush. He's Jacob's wrestler. Jesus is Moses' deliverer. He's Joseph's promise. He's Noah's ark. He's David's song. He's Solomon's wisdom. He's Joseph's dream. He's Ruth's Boaz. He's Esther's timekeeper. He's Jeremiah's fire. I'm talking about Jesus. He's Nehemiah's wall builder. Can I tell you about Jesus? He's Joel's restorer. He's Ezekiel's bone collector. He's Joseph's testimony. He's Amos's justice. Look at somebody and tell him, I tried him and I know him. He's good all by himself, because can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody pick me up, turn me around, place my feet on the solid ground, because I got power. Look at somebody and tell them, launch out. Tell them, walk out of the past. Walk out of poverty. Walk out of pain. Launch out. Come on, you ought to step out of your aisle and just hug somebody. Tell them, if you don't move, I'm going to pull you into where God has called you to be. I'm launching out. Take somebody's hand, if you will, and leave no one untouched. Take one person by both hands. Can we do that as best as we can? Take one person by both hands. Get a prayer partner. Take one person by both hands. Get a prayer partner. God said, where have you been? You can't stay there. Got greater for you ahead. And I'm calling you out for a purpose for such a time as this. I want you to pray for that hand you hold. God respects you so much that he gave you a binding and a loosing hand. He said, whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we bind up depression and we release joy. We come against that spirit of sickness, disease, and suicide right now. You shall not die, but you shall live and declare the works of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, I come against sickness and disease in the name of Jesus. God said, whose report will you believe? We shall believe your report. Show yourself to the priest. I come against every fibroid cyst right now. He's drying it up right now in the name of Jesus. Every malignant tumor right now, every lump, every cyst, come against breast cancer right now in the name of Jesus. You shall not have to have a mastectomy. You shall not have to have a double mastectomy in the name of Jesus. God said, I'm restoring you and healing you right now in the name of Jesus. Even the intense migraines, God said, I'm giving you relief. He said, I'm giving you peace for your pressure right now. In the name of Jesus, touch that body right now from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet. Satan, the blood of Jesus be against you. I call your dream and your vision to come forth right now. Take that vision off the coffee table. Blow the dust off it right now. What didn't work last week, pick it up again. Pick it up again. God said, I'm making you the lender, not the borrower. You're the head and not the tail. Above and not beneath. In the name of Jesus, I call you out into entrepreneurship right now. I call you out of that place of fear and sadness and thinking about how it's not going to work out and happen. It's going to happen in the name of Jesus. Believe again. Have confidence again. Find your greatness again in the name of Jesus. It's your time to come out. Come out of your hiding. Come out with your gifts. Come out in Jesus' name. Loose those hands and give God a praise all over this house. Listen, when we were kids, we would play hide and go seek. Person would run after the others, they put their hands over their eyes while everybody else was hiding. After they counted to three, the last words they said, ready or not, here I come. That ought to be your anthem for your life today. And if that's you and you don't know Jesus, I want you to come. Why don't you come? If you need prayer, if you need salvation, if you need restoration, if you've been afflicted in your body, if you want a new lease on life, if you say, I'm tired of doing things the same old way, expecting a different result, I'm launching out. If that's you, why don't you come? I believe if you clap your hands, somebody will be urged to come. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now. Come on, you can sing it. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you with a loud voice. He will save. This is your time to launch to another level, to do something greater that God has for you. God has given you a great visionary in this house, the celebrated pastor of this house in this particular time in the vineyard, part of the vineyard for such a time as this. Why don't you receive the honorable honorary for this day, third year of pastoring, the Right Reverend, come on, somebody give God praise, for Bobby Joe McKenzie. Give God praise on, come on, don't hate, celebrate.
Amen, you can be seated in the house of the Lord. Let me just start off by thanking God for Jesus Christ, His Son, who died on Friday, but thought it not robbery not to stay dead, but came back early Sunday morning with all power in His hand. And then for calling such a powerful preacher as my friend, my brother, Dr. Eddie Connor Jr. Thank you, brother. And you worked today. Good Lord, have mercy. You worked today. He's working like he's on a plantation, ain't he? my God. Thank you, brother. He travels, he's a writer, prolific writer. He is one of the strong voices of this generation for the gospel. And I'm so glad that he thought it not robbery to come over from the D to preach the gospel to us today. I believe that there's some things supposed to happen before I start talking too much, and then we're going to get you out of here. So I'm going to yield my time, this particular time, to the order of the service, and then they'll tell me what to do, I guess. Amen. So I see some folks with some stuff, so I'm gonna give y'all the mic and let y'all do what y'all do. Sister Esther McGee.
We have grown so much with them, and we just need to thank the Lord. We can't pay them enough for everything that they're doing. But we have some token things that we'd like to give them. Could I have all the SLTs come up?
Amen.
And for you, for those of you who don't know who the SLTs are, this is a strategic leadership team that Pastor has put together. And what we do, we're trying to do the mission, vision, and theme of the church. Amen. So we are trying to work and love each other and just do whatever we need to do for each other. We want to, certainly, we're trying to build another church, so that's one of the things we're trying to do. We would first like to give our, we have some gifts for our pastor, so we'll give him a gift, and then we also have some gifts for his family. And then we have a gift for our First Lady.
So, on behalf of the strategic leadership team, there's one small gift that we have for Pastor, but because of shipping issues, it hasn't arrived yet. So what's going to happen is when it does show up, we as a congregation will present it to him. So, on behalf of us, we love you, brother, you and First Lady. I mean, you guys are a dynamic pastoring team. And we are just so fortunate that God bless Macedonia with you guys to lead us and teach us in His ways. So we just want to say from all of us here on the strategic leadership team and the congregation, thank you guys so much, and we love you guys even more. Amen.
All right, can I have all of Chosen Choir and Dance Team stand right where you are? Just stand where you are, stand where you are. All right, normally we know that for Pastor's anniversary, the church usually gives the pastor and his wife and family a gift. But this particular day, we love you, Pastor and First Lady, but it was more about Jeffrey. So, On behalf of Chosen Generation, choir, and dance team, Jeffrey, can you step forward, please? And Miss Riley has a little token for you. Give it to me. We just want to say thank you for being so faithful and playing the drums for us. We really appreciate you. And we love you. In case anybody, for all the parents who may or may not know, we kind of just did this. But what it is, he's got four pair of drumsticks. Not just regular drumsticks. These drumsticks have his name engraved on them. She's so proud. She wants him to see her right now.
My remarks are thank you so much from the bottom of my heart to the depths of my soul. I appreciate being here. Macedonia, you are a wonderful, wonderful church family. I mean, sanctuary, everybody in the balcony, everybody in the L. Every one of you is a joy to my soul to minister with. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate that we're in this walk together. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Servant leadership, that's what we do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I know that a lot of times, as a church, we go through our ebbs and our flows, our trials, our tribulations. Sometimes we like each other a lot. Sometimes we just tolerate each other. Sometimes you like what we do. Sometimes you love what we do. Sometimes you hate what we do. But the amazing thing is that we still in it together.
Yes, sir.
And I don't count it as a small thing that God will allow 3 years to pass. Because, listen, I'm just going to be real. I can get on my own nerves in 3 years. And so the fact that you, my brothers and my sisters, you're here with smiling faces and you thought it not robbery to celebrate myself and my family and my wife and my kids. So I say thank you. I'm so thankful. Jeffrey for his drums. I'm telling you right now, see, you don't get a lot of reaction out of Jeffrey. But with that, let me interpret that for you. Wow. That was the interpretation for that. It's my daughter Jamila who's away. As soon as we let her know what's happening, I'm telling you, she's gonna lose her mind. And thank you for celebrating my wife. And it's not an easy thing to do what she does. And it's not easy to be married to me. It's not easy to be the first lady of a church. And it's just not easy. And so she do it with grace. And so I'm so thankful to you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Macedonia, I know that many times you're going to hear my name called. My name is the one that seems to get the accolades. But know that every time my name is called, it represents you.
Yes.
And so my face may be out there, my voice may be out there, my name may be out there, but it's us. We in this together. So I say happy anniversary to Macedonia. And this is not a thing that, you know, I can get the big head. Don't ever worry about that. First of all, my head already big. But I'm reminded, Dr. Connor, I'm reminded, Jesus, there's a story in the Bible where Jesus was riding a donkey into the city of Jerusalem, and the people were cheering, and they were saying, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And if I can use my sanctified imagination, I believe that I'm like the donkey. I'm believing in my sanctified imagination that the donkey had to know that they really weren't cheering for him. They was cheering for who was on his back. And so today you're celebrating who's on my back. And his name is Jesus. And because of who's on my back, he allowed me to stay here for 3 years.
Yes, sir.
And it's been 3 years laboring with love. I don't know why God was unfair to all the other preachers. I don't know why he was unfair to all the other preachers.
Yes, sir.
And had them somewhere else, but not in Macedonia.
Amen.
Because Macedonia is the bum diggity. Because you Bible study, you know what I'm talking about. So we say thank you. We say thank you. Let me start from the top as best I can. Thank you to our Chosen Generation praise team, praise dancers. I mean, our praise team, our adult praise dancers. Did boy, y'all did something there. To the leader of that ministry, Sister Renita Craig. Of that ministry, Sister Justine McKenzie. To all of the praise dancers, man, y'all are awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you. To all of you who have, who were a part of the welcome, I want to say that because we was just family today, right? To our Chosen Generation choir, you guys were amazing. And Sister Maya and Brother Xavion for escorting us in, y'all. Made us look good. And Sister Maya, let me just say this. That song you sang, you will never know how much that means to me, because I had a member of my family when I was graduating high school. Although I graduated with high honor roll, I actually had a scholarship to go to college, and I was actually doing extremely well. I had a family member that told me he'll never be anybody. He think he's smart, but he'll never do anything. And that song, every time, and I remember that song came out around that time, and I remember God encouraging me as a teenager. They said I wouldn't make it. And they said I wouldn't be here today. And when I heard that song, this first time in years that I remembered that somebody said something like that. But I want you to know, just like I have seen it in my life, if any of you, if someone has spoken against you, just like the preacher told us, they just launch out. Because usually people talk from the shore, but they won't talk out in the deep. If you go further and higher than they go, you will actually choke them out because they can't go where you go. And so I say thank you for that. Thank you to all of you, the ones who filled in and did things on the program today, the service that you normally don't do. Thank you for that. And then I want to thank the culinary ministry, because I got wind, there's some stuff going on downstairs. Sister Denise Hill, Sister Robbie Jean Patterson, Brother Howard Gray, and many, many others for your labor through the week getting ready for this. And so we're ready to go down and do some chewing. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to turn things back over to preacher for the hour. I'm going to ask, once again, Dr. Khan, could you give him a hand clap? We did is introducing this year, because we know it now. He done been to Macedonia a few times. And Mama used to say, you know, you come one time, you're a guest, and next time, you're family. And so, you're family now, Doc. We appreciate you. But thank you, man. Thank you for coming. That is my brother. That's my friend. And I'm so glad that he came over to share with us today. Praise God. Macedonia, we love you. To Albion, we love you. And eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, and it hadn't even entered into your mind what God is about to do. But it's revealed in His Word. So if you read your Word, you'll know exactly what we're about to do.
Yes,
Dr. Connor, if you don't mind, if you will dismiss us. But before you dismiss us, if you don't mind blessing the food. And then when we're dismissed, I believe we can go immediately to the fellowship hall. And they're waiting for us. And if you guys give me just a couple of minutes, I'm going to, me and the preacher, we got to talk just a teeny weeny bit right after service. And then we'll be down. And then we're going to have a hallelujah good time breaking bread. Dr. Connor.
Somebody give God praise and honor for His family, the jewel of ministry. Come on. Yes. Pastor said, you know, first time you come, you're a guest. Second time you come, you're family. This is my third time, so I might as well be a member. There it is. And three is a significant number. It's the number of perfection. It's the number of completeness. And God is completing some things in your life. Why don't you stand with me as we get ready to dismiss and go down. If you believe that this is your week of launching, why don't you give God praise for it? Kind and gracious Father, we thank you for even the food that we're going to receive and consume today. Bless the hands that prepare it, the mouths that will consume it. Let us have a great time of fellowship and togetherness and unity and just camaraderie as we celebrate today's anniversary, Father. We thank you for a greater time in you. Father, bless everybody as we leave this area, but not your presence, God. Bless us on the streets and the highways and the byways, Father. Cause this word to manifest in our lives. Let it be sown and reap harvest 30, 60, 100 fold. Satan, you cannot choke the word. You cannot leave us depressed, but we are walking in victorious. Walking in victory, living victoriously in the name of Jesus. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless. Unto his presence with exceeding joy, be the only wise God, our Savior. Be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. I pronounce you blessed. I declare you delivered. I declare you to be set free. I declare you to walk in your victory and to launch and live victoriously. In Jesus' name, if you believe it, shout amen.
Amen.
Hook somebody, tell them I love you with the love of the Lord.